Come to It's a new day dawning. It's time. today, Lord, that you come, God, and dwell in our hearts and our lives. And God, that's all we have to ask. Because if you're there, God, you'll take care of everything else. We know that. With faith, we declare that, Jesus. God, let's not forget that we have responsibility, Lord. We have to ask you to come into our hearts and change us, Lord. So I just pray that this morning, God, if there's somebody here that has not done that, Lord, that they would respond and let you change their life, God, because you want to. We know you do because you love us. So God, teach us today. Teach us, God, about that responsibility to invite you into our hearts, God, and let you just dwell there and change us completely. Thank you for that reality. We love you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You can be seated.
This sermon has been 2 weeks in the making. I wanted to preach it last week, but I was sick. And when I mean sick, I mean sick. I ended up in the hospital and was there for 5 days with all sorts of IVs dripping in me to get me back on track. So thank you, George, for stepping in here at the last minute. But I was sick, so that's where I was. And I didn't really want visitors. You know, when you're sick, I just soon get a glass of water and go hide somewhere. So that's, some people like a party. I like to hide. Anyway, I'm here and regrouping, I guess, as we go. This particular sermon is actually a very good sermon. I really like the thrust of it. What we're trying to do is walk with Jesus in the New Testament, and when he interacted with a person, almost stand next to, over his shoulder, and watch what's going on and the dynamics of what's going on and say, what can I glean from this interaction? And so we're going to do a particular text today that's really interesting on a man who was lame. He hadn't been able to walk for 38 years. It implies that he was able to walk, and then something happened, some trauma happened, where he wasn't able to walk for 38 years. Now, that's a long time of not being able to do something. And so he had plenty of time to think it through. And what I want you to wrestle with, maybe your issue is not being lame, but what issue do you have this morning that God, the Holy Spirit, you know, we just sang a song, come Holy Spirit, come Jesus, come deal with me. What is the thing that is there that you don't want to deal with? You know, and I can't tell you what it is. You know what it is when I just say those words. But what is the thing that's there where Jesus says, how can I help you? And you have to wrestle that one out. And the question really becomes is, do I want God's help or not? Do I really want God's help? Or do I want to stay where I am? That's really the question that you're going to need to wrestle with this morning. So we're going to look at this particular person. I'm going to ask you to turn with me, please, to John chapter 5. And we're going to talk about the healing of the invalid at Bethesda. It was a pool in Jerusalem over by what is known as the Sheep Gate. So there was a place where there was a beautiful pool, and there was 5 patios where the sick would come and stay there and wait. And the sick, it mentions, let's just read part of the text here. This is John chapter 5, starting verse 1. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for a feast of the Jews. Now there in Jerusalem, near the Sheep Gate, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by 5 covered colonnades. It'd be like patios. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who had been an invalid for 38 years, when he saw Jesus lying there and learned that he had been that condition for a long time, Jesus asked him, do you want to get well? Now, I'm going to pause here just for a minute because I want us to think. That's a very simple question. It, probably in some cases, it's a little too forward. People say like, well, you know, isn't that a little blatant that you're, I mean, this person's been sick for 38 years, now you're saying, do you want to get well? The obvious answer would be, what? Yes. Yes, I want to get well. But let me just say this. If you're going to, there's a choice you got to make here with all these types of things. And I think life is father filtered from God so that there's no mistakes. And so if he says yes, now he's been in this portico for a number of years, apparently, but he's been sick for 38. Now, when you're lame, what can you not do? You can't walk. you can't probably do things for yourself, and you can't work. So how is he being fed? People have been bringing him food, have been providing for him clothing and water and all these things. So for all these years now, he's been at the gratis of other people. And so he's used to begging. He's used to allowing other people to serve him. So if he says, I want to get well, what goes away? All that support system goes away. And all of a sudden now he has to be responsible for his life, for him taking care of himself, and if he has family, for him now providing for his family. And he has to step up now, literally, into action and work and now be a responsible person. So when Jesus comes along and he sees this man, it's interesting, there's probably dozens upon dozens of people waiting there to be healed, and Jesus sees this one person, and he asks him a very blunt question. Do you want to get well? The answer is yes or no. Now, there's a cost either way. And I guess I want to say for us, everybody here has something, and I think Christ is kind of, hello, anyone in there? Do you want to get well? And he asks us that same question. And we're going to talk through what some of those things can be about do we want to get well. But that's really a really fair question. It's a fair game. And you may be thinking of some other people in your life that are in that very same situation, and you're trying to help them, and they're resisting your help, kind of. You understand what I'm saying? It's like, do they really want to get well or not? We don't know. But you have to make a choice in life. And so this is about responsible living. This is about being responsible for choices. And I want to walk with you down through now how the man responded to Jesus, with hopes that some of you will see some of the things that he did, we do too. And just kind of a checkup saying, is this the way we want to go? So, number one, I have some principles to go along with this. The first one is stop blaming and making excuses. Let's go back up to verse 7 now of John chapter 5. Sir, the invalid replied, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me. So apparently what happened was, once somebody gets healed, there's stories that go out from there, but apparently they would say like an angel would come and stir the waters. You wouldn't necessarily see the angels, but all of a sudden the waters would be stirred, and the first one in is the get-out-of-jail-free kind of thing. You know, they get healed, whatever it is, whether it's they're blind or whether they're lame or whether they're whatever it is, the first one in gets healed. So when Christ asks him, do you want to get well, what does he say? What does he say? Pardon? Yeah. Somebody else is quicker than me. But the reason they're quicker is because what? Somebody else helps them. And I have nobody to help me. So it's not my fault I'm not healed. I don't have anybody to help me. So the reason I am where I am right now is because no one's out there to help me. Okay? Everyone else has somebody else, but not me. When things go bad, how quickly are we to blame someone else or something for our situation or for our choices? Here's a couple ideas. You may want to check them off. If others are sitting there, you may not want them to see, so just put your hand over it. Check off the excuses you may have used in your life for whatever the situation is. I did not know. No one told me. Now, I'll just poke a little fun at that. When we came from Chicago here to Rutland Town, the most common answer for what they did, and we didn't know about it, was, well, that's the way we did it last year. We've always done it that way. But I wasn't in here last year, so I don't know what was done last year. So can you tell me the situation? You know, so I used that one actually a number of times. Everybody just said, well, we do it all, that's how we always do it. But I would find out after the fact because I didn't know we were supposed to do it that way. So I've used that. Another one is, it's not fair. Or they did it too. Now, you'll have a lot of young people, kids will often use that when they're trying to point out why they're excusing themselves or blaming someone else. You know, you come in to administer wise counsel, and they say it's not fair, right? A third one is, I'm not ready, I wasn't prepared, or I'm too tired. So there's just reasons why it couldn't get done. I could not help it, is an answer. Or people say, well, my mom and dad, they did such and such, or my boss or the administration does such and such, the teacher did this, and so there's a cadre of things here where people blame or accuse other people so they aren't dealing with it themselves. Now, I rebel against this. And so when Jesus asked him, do you want to get well, does the man answer the question? He doesn't answer the question. He goes off into his preset mode of why things aren't happening in his world. And in his particular case, he blames it because he doesn't have anyone there to help him in. And other people are faster. Now, before we get down hard on this man, how often, and I want you to think about it this week, how often you give an excuse for a reason you aren't doing something? Well, I forgot. Well, it was too, the stores were closed, or I didn't have the money, or you know what I'm saying? How often does this come out of your mouth of excusing yourself or blaming someone else? And I hope that you can check each other on it. Raise a hand, say, excuse me, or just say something where you can help each other kind of witness, say, let's get over this. Let's stop doing this. And I would say, if you want to get healed, you got to be responsible. You got to take responsibility for your life, for your actions, for your choices, for your words, for your thoughts. I mean, the Bible says, take every thought captive. Well, that's you. So number one, stop blaming and making excuses. On the second side here, what excuse or challenge do you have in your life that you're denying responsibility or blaming others for? And so here's a couple illustrations. Number two is, today Jesus asks us, do you want to get well? I think he does that. And even while we're sitting here, he says, with your situation, you keep thinking about it, talking about it to others. Do you want to get that fixed? If so, there's some responsible actions that you have to take. Are you willing to do that? Are you willing to pay the price? Now, by the way, I have the Holy Spirit, and for those of you who are Christians, you have a whole reservoir of how to think and how to speak and how to act, because the Holy Spirit will guide you in that. So that, as a Christian, it's a wonderful thing. But here's some of the realities. For the man, he was an invalid. What he really needed was physical healing. It's obvious to us, but how about you and I? If one of us is hurt, something happened in their life where there was some abuse or some decision was made around them and they got hurt, many people need inner healing. They need someone to come in and just listen to them and hear them out and say, I can help you with that. Here's what you need. Some people are guilty. They've done stuff and they don't talk about it, but they think about it. And anytime any pastor gets in one particular area about asking for forgiveness or dealing with it, their heart goes immediately to that issue. When I was in the hospital, I can't remember who I talked to, because I talked to a lot of people and had some very good conversations. I think he was in the hospital. Actually, I don't remember, because my mind is foggy, you know, in this area. We got talking about life, and this person said, actually, it wasn't in the hospital. I know where it was now, but I said, what do you do with the things? Have you ever done anything wrong? And they said, I was in a salon one day, a hair salon, and I stole some gum. And I said, hold on to that thought. And then we went talking about other things. I said, now, when we got going and we're talking about salvation, I said, now, what do you do with things like stealing the gum? Now, that happened years ago, but you still remember it. What do you do with that? How do you fix that? Well, the answer is you can't. You have to have God fix that. And that, because she felt guilty for all those years, it's still there. You have to have forgiveness for that. And sometimes, in some cases, restitution. And so I say that because many of you carry around stuff like that. What do you do with that? Well, you got to be forgiven. So you can't just stay here and be guilty. And obviously, there are many greater sins than that, obviously. But a sin is a sin. And so what do you do with that? You have to be forgiven. You have to understand biblical principles of being forgiven. And then you can be cleansed. So the question Christ says is, do you want to be healed of guilt? Because the Bible says in Psalms, he even forgives the guilt of our sin. Well, then I don't have to be guilty anymore. That's right. But do you want to? You have to say yes or no. Being discouraged. There are things that happen in life that just plain we get discouraged on. And it's like, I'm really sad, and that takes a lot of energy out of me, and I don't have time and hope for other things. Well, the opposite of discourage is courage or encouragement. This is, takes away that courage. And so what people need is when they're discouraged, they need to have someone come alongside, but they need to be willing to accept it. Do you want to get well or do you want to stay discouraged? That's really the choice you have to make. Now, yes, there's a place for empathy and listening, but there's a place that now Christ didn't really have a lot of small talk with this man. You notice that? Like, tell me about your life and tell me how you got here. And he didn't say much of that. He just said, do you want to get well? And unbeknownst to this man, he had all the goods to do everything you can think of. But he looked like a regular guy. So someone is discouraged with life. Well, okay, here's the question. Do you want to get well? Or do you want to stay discouraged? Sometimes people are discouraged because of thoughts that they keep thinking about back here, this mud pit that they've been in, or things that have happened, or things that people have said and reinforced said. But do you want to stay there, or do you want to move over here? It's a choice. No. There are many things I could say about that. A little Holy Spirit conviction is moving around the audience, I guess, Okay, let's go to the next one. Somebody's arrogant. You ever been around somebody who's just plain arrogant? They reek it, but they don't see it. They're cocky. They think they got the world by the tail, But nobody wants to be around them because they're arrogant. What a person needs there is humility. Now, do you want to remain arrogant? Or do you want to be where God wants you to be? Which I don't think arrogant is a good word. I think the Lord rewards humility, by the way. Another one is fear of the unknown. There are a lot of people who are afraid to make decisions because they're afraid if they make this decision, we don't know what's going to happen. Or if I do make this decision and it goes beyond what I can handle, what is going to happen? And so they get frozen in time because they're afraid of making a decision. Not everybody's that way, but some people are. And what they need is they need trust. And as a Christian, and you live a Christian life, your life becomes a life of trust. Trust in other people, trust in situations, trust that God will work it out. There's a whole situation. You build a life of trust, and then you become a trustworthy person yourself. That's the awesome thing of that. All of a sudden, people can depend on you because they know if you give your word, you will do it because you're trustworthy. Are the people you're surrounding yourself with trustworthy? Are you trustworthy? The next one, unresolved conflict. Anytime you got more than one person, you got conflict somewhere, it seems. Conflict is a natural part of how we live. Resolution of that conflict is supernatural. You know, if everybody agreed and believed the same thing, you wouldn't have probably conflict because everybody agrees on the same thing. But I don't think life would be well that way, because you need duplicity, but you also need harmony of new ideas and fresh ideas to come up with a better idea. And the concept of working together as a team is marvelous. It's a challenge. In many cases, it seems easier to do it yourself. But to do it together with another person has phenomenal reward. So with unresolved conflict, Christ says, do you want to get well? Or do you want to stay in conflict? That's why I love many of the scriptures that says, if someone is in sin, you who are spiritual, restore him. You know what the next word is? Gently. You who are spiritual, restore them. Don't blast them. It says, you who are spiritual, and that doesn't mean just elders. It means those who are Christians, who are loving God, who are following God. Then you restore the person. It's not to point out their error so much as it is to restore them. You who are spiritual, restore him gently. It's Galatians 6, 1 through 4 is really good there. Romans 12, 18 has become a theme of my life. So far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. It doesn't say you will be at peace with all men, but it says as far as it depends on you. So you go first. And by the way, it gets old going first all the time. Well, that's too bad. That's what the Bible says. So you just do it. And you learn not to make stupid errors yourself. So these are principles. I guess what I'm trying to show you is you know, we look at this man who has been an invalid all these years, and we say, you know, buddy, don't you get it? Just yes or no. Don't give excuses. Don't blame somebody else. But what do we do when it comes to our world? And my friends, if we could apply this in our own life, I think there'd be tremendous healing. And I think people would say, how do you do it? How do you live life like that when you're in pain, when you're sick, when you're not feeling good, when others have criticized, when your life is falling, and you remain positive, and you remain hopeful and trustworthy, and you follow up with your promise? How do you do that? You smile. You say, well, it's all about relationship. And I got a relationship that will never end. It's with my dad. It's my Heavenly Father. He loves me in spite of myself, in spite of my failings, in spite of my arrogance, in spite of my pride. He loves me. And because he loves me, I have the capacity to love others. So, here's all this set up now. The man's answering, wrong answer. It's kind of, you saw my little comment in there. If I were Jesus, here's how I would have responded to the guy. I would have let him have it. I would have said, excuse me, sir, you didn't answer my question. You gave me excuses. Let me clarify. My question is, do you want to get well? Now, whether or not I would have done that, I don't know. But Jesus didn't do that. He just looked down at the man. Look at what happens. He let the man be who he was. Verse 8. Then Jesus said to him, get up. Pick up your mat and walk. At once, the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. Now, can you imagine what that must have looked like? This man had been crippled. He had been sitting there at the pool. You know how people get stiff. You know, even if you sit for a couple hours in a particular way, it's really hard. You got to get things moving and whatnot. This man had been there for 38 years like this. That's several times the age of some of you. Now, does it make any sense for Jesus to say, stand up, pick up your mat? Doesn't make any sense. But the man must have had faith. And I don't know, it doesn't say this. I don't know if Jesus reached down and helped the man up. I don't know. I can envision that personally, that he would do this. But all of a sudden, strength came into the bones and the muscles became healthy. And this man who had been crippled for all those years was able to not only stand up, but to walk. People in that condition have to be trained how to walk. It just doesn't happen. But because it was Jesus, he was able to pick the man up, and the man was able to stand up. And then not only that, to be responsible to pick up his mat and walk. It was unbelievable. It was a miracle. What's missing in that story? Tell me. Who said that? The pool. The pool. The pool didn't. The pool. The wasn't even mentioned. The pool wasn't mentioned. The man said, "Well, but what about the pool?" He didn't need the pool because the healing was not through the pool. The pool was through Jesus. Now, in your the picture that we have up here is the what I call number is. Letter number three, it said the first healing of Jesus was physical and emotional. You have a picture in your bulletin. Can you pull that out for a minute? It's the same picture that's up on the screen here. Bob King came to me with this and showed me this a couple weeks ago, Bob? Yeah. Bob and Honey do a lot of hospital visitation for our church, and they're actually quite good at it. And he showed me this picture. And a couple weeks ago when I was here, I handed out four or five of these, just with people were asking if I could pray for them, which I did. And I said, take a look at this. And they said, can I keep that? And it was so positive. What it is a picture of an operating room, and the doctor's operating on a patient, and Jesus is standing next to the doctor. And where are the hands of Jesus on this? One is on his shoulder as his friend, and the other one is guiding the doctor's hands to do surgery. Now, this is my new favorite picture for healing. This is a wonderful picture because that's how I envision it. Now, like when I was in the hospital here, bring me your drugs, bring me whatever because I'm really sick here. But in the midst of that, I believe in working with doctors and medicine. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But the other part of this, I know that Christ is in the middle of that as a Christian for me. He works all things together for good. And I trust him on that. Now, one day I will pass away. This body will be worn out. And I'll have to trade it in. I'm okay with that. But until then, I'm willing to work with medicine people. And there's some wonderful people up at the hospital. They're great people, great doctors. And they found the right medicine that would help me. But in the middle of all this, I want you to just have a conscious effort. You may want to have a copy of this and maybe pass it to somebody that you're praying for and say, here's just my view of when I pray, this is how I pray in a vision for you. So you may keep that. I keep that in your Bible. And if you need more, we can make more copies of it. But it's just a thought to think through. And in this particular case, Jesus came and he held the man. He healed the man. What a great miracle. I wonder what the others were thinking when they saw this happen right there. Like, me too, you know? But here's what happened. So they healed the man on the Sabbath. It mentions it kind of parenthetically. This is on the end of verse 9. The day on which this took place was the Sabbath. And so the Jews said to the man who had been healed, it is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat. Now, in our culture, it'd be like, what is your problem? this guy has been sick and he couldn't walk for 38 years and all of a sudden he's healed. Can't you see the miracle? Can't you rejoice? This guy had to have a grin like, you know, from here to here on his face and probably leaping and everything else. And they said, well, there's a Sabbath. You can't, you're carrying your mat, you're working. Now, understanding the culture, this was a Jewish culture. Sabbath was the day of rest. You weren't to do any work. Now, where they came down to this was man-made rules. This was not God's rules. This was man-made rules. In fact, Christ even said that the Sabbath was made for man to rest, not vice versa, to be under rules. Now, I want to say this, is when God does something spectacular in your life, not everyone is going to cheer for you, just so you know. Just so you know. And so here's this man, he's getting blasted now because he's carrying his mat, and the legal people are picking on him. Verse 12, so they asked him, these are the leaders now, the Jews, who is this fellow who told you to pick it up and walk? The man who was healed had no idea who it was, for Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there. So Jesus didn't make a big deal out of it. He just told the man stood up and lost focus because his world all of a sudden just exploded. And he lost touch of who said what, and there's probably a big buzz going on, and Jesus kind of just slipped away. He wasn't trying to make a big deal out of himself. He just slipped away into the crowd, and he goes, I don't know who he was. Verse 14, watch this. Later, Jesus found him in the temple and said, see, you are well again. Stop sinning, or something worse may happen to you. Now, what he's saying there is, as he comes to the next issue, the second healing of this man of Jesus to this man was spiritual healing. He first dealt with the prominent need in his life, which was standing up and being able to walk again. But then he came back a second time and he said, oh, by the way, your sins need to be forgiven. Don't continue doing what you're doing. Change your life. Be responsible. See, you are well again. Stop sinning or something worse may happen. The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. Now, that is a simple little statement, but I think it's a profound statement. Because before, when Jesus said, do you want to get well? The man said what? No, I have no one to get me into the pool. Now when he's healed, what did he, and they said, who did it? He goes, I don't know. Kind of slipped into the old pattern. But when Jesus came back to him again and touched him a second time, and he was healed spiritually, this man stood up. In fact, he went to the Jews. He said, oh, by the way, the man who healed me was Jesus. And all of a sudden, you see this man taking responsibility for his life. And it's pretty awesome, because there could have been all sorts of other consequences. And he was actually in the temple. Did you notice it said that? Jesus found him in the temple. Well, if you were sick and all sorts of other problems, you couldn't go into the temple. This man beelined to the temple to meet with God. And he was able to boldly say, it was Jesus who changed my life. This man's a changed man. One day we'll be able to see him in heaven and say, tell us more. Tell us what you were thinking. Tell us what, how did the people respond? What did you do? It'd be very fun to talk about that. Notice how it goes on, though. It's not all fun and games here for Jesus. Verse 16, so because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jews persecuted him. Jesus said to them, my Father is always at his work to this very day, and I, too, am at work. For this reason, the Jews tried harder to kill Christ. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. Now, Jesus knew when he healed this man, this man would go tell the Jews it was him, and he knew that this was another nail aimed toward him, and that his life was even more at risk now, that the cross was coming, but he was fearless of that because he came to do that very thing. I wonder how this man, if he ever saw Christ again. I wonder how his life was different. I wonder, where did he go work? How did he provide for his family? How did his world change because he met Jesus? And then was able to go tell the critics, yes, I'm one of his. Where are you this morning, my friends, with the issue that you may have that you've been dragging along behind you? Jesus is asking, do you want to get well? And then he has the resources to fix it. But you have to be willing and you have to be responsible. Say, I'm willing. I'm willing to take the cost to deal with it. I'm willing to go get help. You see, what we do is we end up doing all sorts of other things. Instead of dealing with real issues, we get into anger and rage. We rage out on people because we're angry. We tell people off. People get into substance abuses of all different kinds because they're trying to drown their sorrows, whether it be alcohol or drugs or whatever, and they just try to drown their sorrows because they don't want to deal with the issues. And some people just plain avoid stuff. They don't want to talk about it. They don't want to think about it, or they avoid the people that might be causing the pain, so they just run away. What I am saying is, stand up and tell God that you're willing to go for it. And then take responsible action, whether it be go find the person, go find the organization, go to the person, whatever it is. Be responsible. And when you do that, the Holy Spirit will come alongside you as a Christian and say, you're making right choices. Good for you. Well done. This is just a test. This is just a test, by the way. Because the real life is going to happen after you go to be with the Father. And wouldn't it be cool to say, yep, I passed the test. And then there was another test. And I passed that one. And I was responsible in my decision making. And I chose to love people, even though it was hard. Let's stand and let's close.